ladies and gentlemen. First and foremost, I would like to thank UNSA, especially the president, Remy, and also Florentina for this invitation. It's always a great opportunity to come to Romania. It's not my first time, but every time it was really interesting, and I take a lot of inspiration and also ideas back with me home then for the daily work. Before I start, I would also like to recognize the honorable member of the Romanian Parliament. We work very closely with the European Parliament, and we just know how important it is to also create the link to the national parliament. So I hope you find that also interesting. When Florentina and Remy asked me to come and speak, I always use this as an opportunity and a time for reflection. Yeah, because in our daily work, there is so much time spent on, the dreadlock, and it's always good when you are invited then to start thinking, okay, what have we actually achieved in the last year, and what is it what we still need to work on and focus on. And for me, I think it's also important to convey the message that the last 5 years at European level was a tremendously busy time. We had a commission that worked very hard under the crisis, under the impression of the crisis. But this has led to, at least in my professional experience, to a relatively unprecedented avalanche of new legal initiatives. We counted only in insurance. There were 130 initiatives in 5 years. So that means 2 initiatives per month. And when you think about that, of course, all these initiatives, I mean, one of them is Solvency II. It's, of course, a huge project on which we have worked for 14 years, but there are also smaller initiatives. But nevertheless, these are the initiatives you ultimately have to implement then also, not only in national law, but also in your daily business. And this is why it is so important that we pay attention how this is done. And today I want to focus on 3 elements, really, that I think are of concern to you. First, obviously, Solvency II. I would then also like to speak about all the initiatives taken at a European level on distribution, and then also maybe a few words on motor. On Solvency II, when I started working on it 8 years ago, I must say the mood about Solvency II was extremely positive. Where are we now? I think throughout the process, we ventured between levels of pure excitement and then, periods of sheer frustration. I think we are currently, we have passed the valley of frustration because we have now a new European Commission, also a parliament that have seen that not everything that was done in the last 5 years has worked as it was originally intended. We have seen in the last 5 years a number of developments where we thought we get probably a Solvency II development that is much more detailed, much more complex, much more comprehensive than it was originally foreseen. So we think now with a new commission, with a new parliament, there is a possibility also to address it. But let me maybe start just by, highlighting Solvency II overall. I think the assessment is still that this is a good project. Why? Because in the end, the idea was that it should allow you as leaders of the industry to have a better risk assessment of your own company, to detect risks early on. And because we are insurers, and unlike banks, we then have time to address these issues over time. So the concept of Solvency II is still something that we very much like. Have we gotten it all right? Probably not. What we see first and foremost is that we are about to replace a very outdated Solvency I by this new system, Solvency II. But Solvency I was less than 200 pages at European level, and we now go to Solvency II with more than 3,000 pages. And while pages are just probably maybe a bit of a simplistic way of demonstrating the complexity, I think it's very telling. Because, of course, these more than 3,000 pages, each one of you need to read, need to implement, but also supervisors need to look at it, need to implement it. And the compliance cost is really quite impressive. So we have a complex law, and we think that certainly in a period where we now have relatively limited time to implement, we are still confronted with latest updates. We still have not yet seen all the input that we need to really implement this law. As Remy was saying, we are 194 days away from implementation, but important elements such as reporting or also equivalence decisions have not yet taken, and we are still waiting for them. And when I look at reporting, we have 271 reporting templates and their variations that then need to be implemented. So you can see that that is a tremendous challenge, and I imagine especially also for a market like yours, it will be a tremendous challenge because it's the sheer size of the exercise that is really sometimes frightening. So complexity, one element, and the lack of time for implementing it. We have originally said we need 18 months, and as I said, we don't have all the elements and less than 200 days to go. The second point, probably also of interest, proportionality principle. We have always been saying we need to be careful that this very complex system should be implemented in such a way that it really fits with the size and the complexity also of the relevant insurers, and that smaller insurers shouldn't have to go through the same level of complexity and detail as maybe large insurance groups. We see that while the proportionality principle is in the directive, in practice, and when we look at implementation, the margins of maneuver to use this proportionality principles have been reduced quite considerably, and we want to address that. And the last big element I think I want to mention on Solvency II is what we are not happy about and have not been happy throughout the process is that Solvency II does not really address the life insurance business model as it should be addressed. Because we measure risks really on a daily basis and subject also the life business to daily valuation. But if you match your assets and liabilities, we believe that is not appropriate. And therefore, we would look for a different approach for life insurance. We have, I mentioned it in the beginning, now the positive development that the commission, the new commission, is very open to look into these issues, and Commissioner Hill has told us recently that at least for investment, for the infrastructure investment project, he would intend to open solvency even before it is implemented and to introduce change. And we hope that this opening would also give us an opportunity to really address the larger problems that we see with the treatment of the life business under Solvency II. So a ray of hope in all this when we look at Solvency II. The second element or part I wanted to talk to you about is conduct of business, so sales process. We have also had a very busy agenda on that in the last 5 years. You are probably familiar with the Insurance Mediation Directive review. We have the PRIIPs, the Packaged Retail Insurance Investment Regulation. And then there are obviously also rules under Solvency II that address the sales process. Now, the problem from our perspective is that when European regulators looked at these directives, they looked at them in isolation. What we have done now is we have just looked at the normal sales process. Let's say a broker sells online a life insurance investment product, and we have clearly seen and now demonstrated at European level, both to the Commission, Parliament, and EIOPA, that if you do that, five European directives apply. The Insurance Mediation Directive, the PRIIPs regulation, Solvency II directive, and the e-commerce and distance marketing directive. But because these directives have been negotiated in isolation, nobody has looked at the combined effect. The combined effect of this is that if we now inform consumers about, you know, in the pre-contractual stage, about the product, about the sales process, our information requirements move from currently 74 up to 178. So we increase the sales rules by 388% and the product disclosure rules by 340%. And what is worse, there is also a lot of duplication in that. So we are addressing that currently in a trilogue process at European level in the Insurance Mediation Directive. We hope that we can still get a number of these reporting requirements ironed out so that we can reduce the overall number and that we can really do a good service to our consumers. Because don't get me right, the idea is clearly to provide transparent and good information, but we fail to see how a sheer number of over 150 information requirements helps a customer to shop around. All it does is it increases the compliance burden on our industry, and it also basically makes the consumer not see the wood for the trees. And therefore, we think it's much better to have less information, better information. And also, honestly, it's a reputational issue. We all know that insurers are always seen as the one hiding everything in the small print, that many of these issues are, in fact, going back to European regulation is something that is sometimes slightly overlooked. So that's clearly an issue we want to address continuously. My last point is maybe on motor. We have seen in the last a mandate of the Commission, a lot of focus on, as I said, Solvency II, prudential rules, conduct of business rules. We see that now the attention shifts back more to the branch lines. We have a new commissioner who is very worried that he sees there are huge differences between motor premiums in different member states. So we will discuss with him in the autumn why it is a good thing that there are different premiums in different countries and that that is in fact a sign of good competition and not one of basically price alignment. So that will be very a very hot topic. But what we also have more and more at European level is the after effects of now dealing with new technological developments. We had the e-call directive where you have this automatic call systems where you cars automatically call emergencies but also repair shops, where we have fought very hard to ensure that car manufacturers cannot just simply send it to their garages, but where we can ensure that there is an open platform where we can have choice and keep prices low for the benefit of insurers and customers. But there are other areas where we have now an easy platform of cooperative intelligence transport systems where we look to how can autonomous cars impact the insurance sector. So there are a lot of developments. Maybe I should also mention CETA, because obviously I know that that is a very hot topic here in Romania, and Florentina and Remy have also shared with us the law and have asked us to make a short assessment also in terms of how do we feel that would work with European legislation. We have looked at it and felt that it would potentially cause problems, certainly with Solvency II, because risk management is certainly challenged if the risk management function to a large extent would be mandatory outsourced and basically taken away from the remit of the insurance company who ultimately holds the responsibility. We also see problems with the motor insurance directive and the treaty overall, and last but not least, also with the professional qualification directive. We have shared that with the Commission. I know that the Commission has also written to the Romanian government, so I think a response is still outstanding, but that are clearly issues that I think are high also on the radar in Brussels and where the Commission would engage. It is, of course, at this stage still at a period where Solvency II is not yet in place, but there is also in the Commission a feeling that if there is a potential infringement, then that should be addressed right from the start. So maybe I leave it here. I thank you very much for your attention.